6 miles to Chicago. We got a full tank of gas, half a pack of cigarettes. It's dark, and we're wearing sunglasses.
Hit it.
Good evening, everybody. Mark Klein with you on another Long Island Blues Warehouse. Welcome. Every week on this stage, we bring you some of the finest players, basically, known to man. Tonight, we are talking to two brothers well known in the rock arena. Collectively, these brothers have worked with Rainbow, Black Sabbath, Blue Oyster Cult, Vanilla Fudge, just to name a few. On the stage with us right now, please welcome Long Island's own Ron Dinelli. This week's featured artist, Ron Dinelli. It got about 10 degrees hotter since we did that one at Terry. I want to start with Teddy Rondinelli, guitar and vocals. How you doing, Teddy?
Good, man. I'm doing real good.
A little closer on that mic if I can trouble you.
Doing real good.
That's what we call coming out of the gate strong, I want to begin by saying. Lord have mercy.
Thank you.
I want to start with some history with you, if I can, Ted. Let's talk about when you began doing that amazing thing you do, playing the guitar, of course. How old were you? What made you decide this is something in life you were going to do?
9 years old.
You were nine?
Nine.
What made you decide this is something you were going
to
do?
My father used to take us to the Fillmore East.
At age nine?
Every week. Like about around 10.
He waited till...
I started at nine, and by 10 we were at the Fillmore.
He wanted to wait till you hit double digits.
That's it.
So at age 10, you're going to the Fillmore with Dad, checking out live music.
That's right.
What kind of bands were you checking out back in those days?
Tina Turner, Janis Joplin, Vanilla Fudge, Mountain, Cactus,
Led Zeppelin,
Jeff Beck. Jeff Beck was the first concert.
Jeff Beck was your first concert?
Yeah.
At age like 10?
Yeah.
Can you describe what that was like to see for you at such a young age?
It was amazing. Blew me away.
And so he was a big influence for you?
Yep.
Now, so you're taking lessons at age 9 and 10?
9 years old.
And how far into lessons before you start like leading projects and starting bands and stuff?
With 10.
At age 10, you got your own band going on?
Yep.
You pick up a guitar at age 9, right. And at age 10, you're playing.
About 10 or 11, what was it, Bobby?
About 11.
Yeah.
You remember your first project, your first band?
The name, The Wanderers.
You were in a band called The Wanderers.
The Wanderers.
What a great beginning for you, my man. Yeah, what a great beginning. What about junior high and high school days? Were you still doing The Wanderers?
Playing in Tusk.
You were in a band called Tusk?
Band called Tusk with my brother. Yeah.
Very cool,
doing
man.
A lot of club circuit.
Very cool. We got a lot to do in a short period of time, my man. I say we jump into another tune. We'll come back and continue the Rondinelli journey.
Cool.
What are we doing next?
Song by Cactus called Evil.
You good to go?
Yep.
Once again on the Blues Warehouse, we're going to keep it moving with Rondinelli.
Yeah. this is Desiree from Farmingville, New York, and you're listening to the Long Island Blues Warehouse.
Sunshine when she's gone. Only clouds when she's away. Ain't no sunshine when she's gone. She left my happy home. Every time she goes. I've been walking down the rocky road, miles of tears I've shed for her. Ain't no sunshine when she's gone, like a dog without a bone. Every time she goes.
This week's featured artist, Ron Danelli. Nicely done, gentlemen. Nicely done. Hey, Teddy, let me ask you a question, my man. I heard a story, a little bit of a rumor, maybe you could set me straight on this, that at a show, Leslie West from Mountain dedicated a song to you.
Yep.
Can you talk about that a little bit? What was that? What was that?
It was amazing.
Where was the show?
Where was it? Bolton Center.
Okay,
Bolton
in Bayshore.
Yep.
So he gets up on the stage. And obviously,
you said I want to dedicate this to a guitar player, a lot of people you know, Teddy Rondinelli. And when he was done, I felt like I was flying.
What was the song he played?
People Get Ready.
Unbelievable, man. Unbelievable. Yeah. Real quick, let's touch on something many people are aware that you were a part of. You had the opportunity to work with Vanilla Fudge.
Amazing.
How did that come about?
Friend of mine, Randy Pratt, who I'm playing in a band with right now called Rickety.
Rickety, sure.
He said to Carmine, he's your guitar player. And that was it. I was in the band.
End of story, huh?
That was it.
Well done, my man. Well done. You still talk to those boys today?
Yep.
Any reunions or any jams with those boys to speak of?
Nothing that I know of right now.
But the door's open.
I guess.
All right. Well, I look forward to I'll tell you what, I'm going to put a few calls in myself, see if we can't make that happen, man. I'd love to see it. Cool. I want to head over to your brother, if I can, on the drum kit, Mr. Bobby Rondinelli, if he'll pull that mic around in front of him. How you doing, Bobby?
I'm good. How are you, Mark?
It's good to see you again, my man. You and I were talking earlier about 4 years ago. I had an opportunity to introduce 10 Years After at B.B. King's in New York City. And one of your local Long Island bands, the Lizards, did the opening act for that show.
Yeah, that's right. I remember
so
that.
So it was cool to hang out and BS with you backstage on that a little bit. And then you and I were in the back of the room watching watching Rick on drums do his little solo. And the two of us mesmerized at what he was all about.
Yeah, he's a great guy. We're good friends.
Very cool. Very cool. Let's start with some history with you. Let's talk about when you began. First of all, a lot of people aren't aware of this with you. I mean, obviously, they know you did the Rainbow thing. And let's see, Black Sabbath, Quiet Riot. You worked with a little bit Blue Oyster Cult. Before you played the drums, you started on guitar.
Yeah.
What made you decide you were going to play the guitar in the early days?
Well, I really never wanted to play guitar. I always wanted to play drums, but we lived in Brooklyn in an apartment building, and it was really, you know, drums were loud and guitar, not the way my brother plays it. But
I don't know what that means.
Acoustic guitar is low.
Sure, sure, sure.
You know, so my parents got me an acoustic guitar.
And you weren't really into it?
I started to get into it a little, and then my teacher said, you got to do a recital, and I said, all right. You know, and he says, you got to sing. I go, sing? I don't want to sing.
You weren't into that at all?
No. And I actually, every time I would touch my hair, I was losing my hair.
At what age?
At 10.
At age 10, you're losing your hair?
Yeah, I'm going
to due to what? Stress? Just being stressed out?
We didn't know what it was. My parents brought me to a bunch of doctors, and nobody knew what it was. And finally, this one woman doctor asked my parents to leave the room, and she goes, child, you doing anything you don't want to do? So I says, yeah, I'm playing the guitar, and I got to sing, and I don't want to sing. And she starts laughing and calls my parents back in the room and said, this kid doesn't want to play guitar, and he really doesn't want to sing. I stopped playing guitar. My hair stopped falling off. I got a drum set 3 weeks later.
No kidding.
True story.
And that's how it began for you.
Yeah.
You grew into the passion with the drums early, I'm guessing.
Yeah, I always like hitting things, and I always, gravitated to the drummer, you know. I just thought it was a cool thing.
Hitting things? You and your brother weren't hitting each other.
We did a bit of that. We did a bit of that.
It was typical brothers growing up.
Oh, absolutely.
I think I can relate to that. Let's talk about what you were doing junior high school days musically. Were you involved in garage bands and school projects and things like that?
Yeah. When I was a kid, I was in bands with guys older than me. And then when my brother got a little older, we started playing together. And we had a band called Tusk that started when we were in Brooklyn and continued out here on Long Island. But I played with other Long Island bands as well, you know, when I was a kid, called Railway and Gun and Bonnie Parker Band and Samantha. But me and my brother always played together.
Very cool. Very cool. Nice highlight for you, I'd have to say, back in the early 80s. Maybe it was 1980, actually. A big-time favorite band of mine back in those days, Ritchie Blackmore and Rainbow. Before you did the Rainbow thing with Blackmore, I understand you auditioned for a band a few people might be familiar with called Kiss.
It was actually the same time as Rainbow. This was all going on at the same time. I was up for the Kiss gig. It was between me and Eric Carr. It got down to the two of us, may he rest in peace. From 2,000 guys, it was between the two of us.
Out of 2,000 guys, it winds up being you and Carr.
Yeah.
In the running.
And Richie had already asked me to join Rainbow. And I actually had him on hold for a week, you know, and I'm like, and I was always into Rainbow. I was never really a Kiss guy, you know what I mean? So I called Richie and I said, look, if you still want me, I want to do Rainbow. And he goes, what if Kiss calls? I'll say, I said, I'll tell him I got a gig already. And I got a Dear John letter from Kiss a couple of days later saying thanks but no thanks, which is nicer than most people because most people just won't call you.
Right.
You know, and I got the Rainbow gig.
Probably Gene Simmons doing, I'm guessing. You know, being the gentleman type guy that he is, he probably said, let's send this guy a letter.
Yeah.
We appreciate him coming down. Just a guess. I could be wrong. Very cool, man. How long did you have a run with Rainbow for?
I was with them for 3 years.
Nice. Nice. I know you did world tours. You did how many albums?
Two and a half. Well, we did an EP. We did two albums, and we did the Jealous Lover EP.
Sure.
And live videos and two real studio albums.
Very nice, my man. Great beginning for you. We got a lot more to do in a short period of time. I said we jump into another tune. We'll come back and talk more with you and some of these other fine players.
Sounds good.
What are we doing next, Bobby?
I think we're going to do a song called Crying in the Rain.
You fellas good to go?
Yeah, man.
Ed Terry?
Yeah, man.
Good to see you again, my man.
All right, I'm ready.
Building a few frequent flyers with us here on the Blues Warehouse.
Oh, forget about it.
And we're happy to say that.
I'm happy to be here. You know that.
We're glad to have you. We're going to come back and talk with you in a bit. Once again, on the Long Island Blues Warehouse, we are going to keep it moving with this week's featured artist, otherwise known as Ron Dinelli.
Black and moan when it burning with a fever. Thoughts of retribution. And a man starts weeping when he's sick and tired of life.
Good day.
This week's featured artist, Ron Danelli. Nicely done, gentlemen. The very charismatic Ed Terry lead vocals. Kick-ass as always, my man. Hey, Bobby, let me grab you again for a second before we bring some of these other boys into the mix. Just an amazing, amazing history you've got in terms of things you've done. The Black Sabbath thing. When did you work with those boys?
In the 90s.
Okay. How long was that run?
About 3.5 years.
How'd you get involved with that project?
Well, I was with this band called Doro, German girl singer Doro Pesch. And
okay.
Her tour manager, a guy named Robert Gambino, was a good friend of mine and used to work for Sabbath, used to work for IOMI.
Okay.
So I told him I'd really love to play with Sabbath, you know. So he says, if I ever hear anything, I'll let you know. So he gives me a call one day.
10 minutes later.
Yeah, I wish. He gives me a call and goes, Ron Danelli, Sabbath needs a drummer. So I says, really? I says, well, give him a call. He goes, I can't call Tony's house. His wife doesn't like me. So he gave me Tony's number, Tony Iommi's number.
So you call.
And I called, and I spoke to his wife.
She had no beef with you, right?
No. And, you know, I introduced myself. And she goes, Tony's out at the moment. I'll give him the message. And 10 minutes later, I got a call from Iommi. And he said he had my name on the list anyway. They were going to get in touch with me, but... It wound up, you know, it was that easy. I called, I went over, jammed, and got the gig.
As simple as that. I'm sure it was basically that simple. Let's talk about Blue Oyster Cult. Another great guitar player here on the island, you probably heard of before, a fellow named Phil Grande.
Yeah.
What's the chance you two were involved in that project at the same time?
I didn't even know he was in that.
Oh, yeah. You weren't even aware?
No, I swear.
He had a short run with those boys, but yeah, he played guitar with Joe Cocker. I know he did
I know Phil. I know his history. I just didn't know he was in Blue Oyster Cult.
Yeah, he did a Blue Oyster Cult tour a little bit as well. It was a short-lived thing.
Yeah,
we weren't
in it together.
Okay. When did you get involved in that project?
After Sabbath.
Okay. How long did that last?
About 8 years.
All right, very real. 8 years.
Yeah, long time.
Very nice, my man.
I'm still good friends with those guys.
One thing that really blew my mind about 3 years ago, in September, I had my second wedding anniversary.
Wow,
my wife and I head over to Mohegan Sun for our second year anniversary, and who do we see playing in the Wolf Den? But Bonnie Tyler, with Mike DeMeo on keys and you on the drum kit.
Yeah.
How'd you guys get involved in working with her?
Well, Mark Reale, who was probably the guitar player on that tour from Riot.
Okay.
I think he was the guitar player on that tour.
Wait, the band Riot?
Yeah, I played on a Riot album. Not Quiet Riot, Riot.
I thought that was Mike Flint.
Yeah, he's a guitar player, but the leader of the band is... I just said his name now. I went blank. Mark Reale.
That's it, yeah.
Yeah, he's the leader of the band.
Okay,
and
okay.
I played on a Riot album. So we became friendly, and he got called to be the MD for the Bonnie Tyler thing. And he called DeMeo, and they both said, why don't we use Bobby? So that's how I got involved with Bonnie.
Very cool, man. Very cool. You still work with her today at all?
Yeah, absolutely. We're supposed to do some dates around now, but she decided to postpone them.
She sounds just as good today as she did back in the
great.
80s.
She's a really, really... great singer, nice lady.
You and your brother, same thing, by the way. You guys sound just as good today as you boys did in the 80s.
Thank you.
Let's talk about this Ron Danelli thing you boys did. When did that project come about?
This version?
The original Ron Danelli thing you did.
Because this version came about last week.
I heard. But what a great ensemble. Who cares if it was 10 minutes ago?
Yeah, right. These guys are great.
Just a great contribution to what Long Island has to offer in terms of music, what we're doing tonight. So, well done, let me begin by saying. But let's talk about the original lineup for Rondinelli. When did that come about?
The original lineup was after I left Rainbow.
Okay.
You know, we took a year to put a band together, and we had the original lineup, I think, was Teddy, myself, James Lomenzo.
That name sounds familiar.
He went on to White Lion and
okay.
Black Label Society and plays with a lot of people.
Very nice.
And the late Ray Gillen. We found Ray Gillen. He played with Jakey Lee and Badlands.
Okay,
and,
sure.
And he played with Sabbath for a while. Sabbath actually stole him from us. but he passed away. So Rondinelli, we've been on and off, you know, since the 80s. And we hooked up with Rob, I guess, the late 80s, right?
Mr. Rob DiMartino.
Yeah, man. We needed a bass player, and I ran into his brother or something, and he suggested him. And I said, really? And he learned this show in all originals, difficult ones, in like a week. I mean, he had cheat sheets everywhere. If there was a breeze, he would have been ruined. But he did great. He did absolutely great. I remember the
hell of an accomplished bassist, my man.
Yeah, he's a Long Island staple now.
No question. Very cool, my man. Very cool. We're going to come back and talk to your bass player and your singer shortly. Let's jump into another tune. We'll keep it moving. What are we doing next, gentlemen? What do you think, Ed Terry?
You know what's next? Communication Breakdown.
Is that the name of the song?
I would think. Either that or it's me. I'm having a breakdown.
Here we go. Blues Warehouse.
Baby, you can hold your guy.
Oh, yeah. This week's featured artist, Ron Danelli. Excellent gentleman. Hey, Teddy, you want to know something? I got a niece that just turned 10. I think I want to start taking her out to see you play.
Come on. Bring them on down.
The way your dad did with you when you were 10. Unbelievable, my man. Got about another 6 or 7 degrees hotter in here since you did that one. You getting hot wearing that coat, man? You're looking good. That's the main thing.
You got to cover the baby fat.
Cut that out. Who you kidding? Let me grab on bass if he'll head on up to his mic, Mr. Rob DiMartino. Holding down the bottom end real well, I got to begin by saying. It's good to see you again.
Good to see you.
We had you in here a few years ago with a local Long Island fella named George Cintron.
Yes.
Played with, I think he did the Trans-Siberian Orchestra way back when, didn't he?
Yeah, and Enrique Iglesias.
And some other cool things.
Yeah.
Very nice. Let's talk about the history with you. Let's talk about when you began holding down the bottom end, doing what you do. Did you start as a young guy yourself?
Yeah. Music was always in my family. My brothers were older than me. And so, like, basically when I came home from the hospital, they were rehearsing in the basement. You know.
And you were being exposed to it at that age?
Yeah, so I started playing seriously guitar like 9 years old.
And you started with the guitar?
Yeah, and then I switched over to bass when I was like 14.
14. And do you still play guitar today?
I haven't
today?
Gotten better since. What?
You still play guitar today?
Yeah, a little bit. Acoustic stuff. You know.
Are you as passionate about guitar as you are with the bass?
Yeah, I like it. You know, it's music, man.
It sure is. And you're a hell of a contributor to the Long Island scene in terms of what you do. Let's talk about junior high and high school days for you. What were you doing musically? Were you involved in like garage bands and school projects?
Yeah, I had a local band, you know, playing the youth centers and stuff for like $100 for a while. Then I got into like the lounge scene, playing lounge bands.
You went through that phase
in
life.
I was like 17 years old and stuff, so it was like my first thing. But
you went through that phase in life a little bit.
Yeah, you know, whatever.
When did you get involved in Long Island guitar legend George Cintron?
Actually, we were doing a record, and we brought George in for...
You're pointing at Bobby?
Yeah, me, Bobby, and Teddy were doing a record, and we brought George in to do some vocals, and we hit it off, and then he needed a bass player for some gigs. I started playing with him. And then.
How long ago are we talking?
88, 89, something like that.
Very cool. And you still work with him today?
Yeah.
Very nice. Love to get him back in here with you if we can do this again.
Sure
I know he's got a crazy schedule himself, but help me out, man.
Cool.
Help me out.
I'll put it in a
Let's see if we can't do it. You do something steady once a week here on Long Island with which Ron Danelli brother?
It's actually me, Bobby, and George Cintron.
Okay.
Doing every Tuesday night. Katie's in Smithtown.
Katie's in Smithtown.
Yeah, on Main Street.
Is that a jam or is that a
No, it's a gig. You know, we bring up special guests. Ed comes down. Ted comes down and plays all the time. So it's not like that open mic chaos that usually ensues.
A lot of those going around the island. I mean, those are great ways to support each other with the scene, but this is a gig you guys do once a week together.
Yeah, it's a lot of fun. We get to stretch a little bit.
Very
play,
cool. You know. Any other projects you're involved in to speak of right now?
Just doing some session work, playing bass for this American Idol contestant, Sarah Mather. She's in the studio now.
That name sounds familiar.
Yeah, it was like I don't even remember what season it was, but she's great. And, you know, just playing in the city a lot and doing what I can.
You go to jams yourself?
Not really. Unfortunately, I'm always playing.
You don't have time.
I don't really get a chance to. But
you're a heavy gun for hire, man.
Well,
massive contributor to the Long Island scene, Rob DiMartino. We thank you so much.
Thank you.
It's always good to see you on this stage and other things you do. Let's keep it moving. We'll jump into another tune. We'll come back and talk to our fearless singer. What are we doing next, Ron Danelli Brothers?
We're gonna do a song featuring Teddy on vocals called "Living Proof."
That I wrote.
You good to go, Teddy? We'll be right back.
wife was living proof.
Oh, yeah. This week's featured artist, Rondinelli. Teddy Rondinelli, lead guitar and vocals. Nicely done, Teddy.
Thank you.
As always. Man, what a singer. When did you realize singing was something you wanted to do? Your brother never wanted to sing. Did you sing early? At a young age?
Yep.
And did you like the way you sounded at a young age?
Well, I don't know. Who knows?
Do you like the way you sound today?
I guess.
I do.
Thank you.
And that's what counts.
Thank you very much.
You know, as the patron, as the viewer.
Thank you very much.
Glad you don't have any of that going on. Although that would have been a great raspy bluesy thing you had going on there. Nicely done, my man. Excellent job. This week's featured artist, Rondinelli. Let's grab Ed Terry, that charismatic frontman on this project tonight. How you doing, Ed? It's good to see you again.
It's great to see you, man. Let's, I mean, you know, it's nice being here. It's a beautiful thing. And
That being said, what's new since I last saw you about an hour ago?
Well, I put my jeans on one leg at a time. The difference is, you know,
what is the difference?
I'm singing with you, hanging out here with some great people, a lot of great talent, and that's about the size of it, Mark.
That having been said, that's a good way to start things off, I think.
Right.
Let's talk about some history with you. We had you in here a couple of weeks ago with Richie Cannata. You lent a great contribution to that show, and we thank you so much again for that.
Thank you.
We didn't get a chance to really talk about you. I had some emails. People were like, man, guy sounded great with the couple cuts he did on that one. Who is this guy? What's he all about? Let's shed some light on that tonight. Let's talk about when you began vocally. When did you get started as a musician? When did you decide? The number one musical instrument on the planet, obviously, the voice.
Exactly.
Did you start little? Did you start at a young age?
Yes, I was small.
Like this?
I was like about this high, you know what I mean? No, but I started very young because my mother was a singer. My father was a trumpet player.
No kidding.
Uh-huh. So music, you know, was basically in my family from the day I was born. And so I expanded on that in a sense that, you know, I've always heard all this great stuff. It was great for me, an education.
What kind of music were you listening to? Do you remember what kind of music you were hearing in the house, being exposed to as a kid?
Well, it was... Actually, there was some opera involved, too, you know, like Così Fan Tutte and a few things like that. Then it was like basically standards, a lot of big band stuff. My mother used to love that. Yeah, my father was playing the trumpet all the time. So, you know.
When did you start singing out in front of the public? Do you remember at what age?
Yeah, about 12 years old.
No kidding.
Yeah.
Remember your first gig?
Yeah, I was about 13, and it was at a bar in Deer Park. I had phony proof. And
I was waiting to hear my junior high or my elementary school.
Well, I did that, too.
What was the bar? What was the bar in Deer Park? Do you recall?
It was on Deer Park Avenue.
Okay.
And I think it was Cheers later on. I don't remember what
the
it was.
The Rock Club Cheers.
Time. Right?
The St. James Infirmary.
That's it.
No kidding.
Oh, yeah.
No kidding.
Yeah, that was one of my things, and... Then it was the junior high school and the high school, you know, and the battle of the bands. And
you did all of that.
I did all that.
You did all of that. Yeah. Let's fast forward to some highlights for you, a couple of cool things that you've done. You had an opportunity to work with Fleetwood Mac.
Yes, I did. I played on the record.
How'd you get involved with those boys and girls?
Well, I used to do a lot of records in the sense that I'd be playing on these different records. I've also, you know, did a lot of studio work, synthesized production and so forth. Used to work with Jelly Bean Benitez, Steve Thompson, and Michael Barbiero. And I used to do a lot of these dance records and basically, you know, different records. So I'd be Fleetwood Mac, Madonna, Whitney Houston, that kind of thing.
David Bowie. Slash.
I performed with Slash live.
Where?
That was in Miami, a place called Roses.
No kidding.
Yeah, it was great.
Stevie Wonder.
Stevie Wonder, yeah, that was interesting. I was singing background with that, so.
Unbelievable, my man. Who cares? You were on the stage with him.
Oh, it was great. It was like an experience.
Who cares if you were sweeping up behind him? You were on the stage.
Well, I did a little of that at the end, yeah.
just a tremendous, tremendous contribution in your own right to the local Long Island scene, man. You've been around the world and back. You've done a tremendous amount of things over the years, and it's always good to see you do your thing. How did you hook up with the Rondinelli brothers?
Well, you know, it's funny because I used to watch these guys, you know, way back then, and I used to go, wow, killer, you know? And finally, one night in a club, it was in Port Jeff, right? I came down, I sat in, and the Village Pub, I think it was.
Port Jeff.
Yeah.
112.
Yeah, that's right. And that's when we started to get to know each other. And how long ago was that? 10 years? 12.
You're testing Bobby's memory again.
I know. It's.
That's all right.
Doesn't gone.
Doesn't make you a bad guy. Doesn't make you a bad guy. Just a tremendous talent in your own right, my man.
Thank you.
You do the jams with Richie Cannata in the city there at the Bitter End.
I do that every Monday.
Very cool, man.
Or every other Monday for me.
Jim Moran. You work with Jim Moran on a few things from time to time. I had you in here about a year ago with Jim Moran.
Oh, he's a talented guy.
Who's a part of that jam as well. And it's always good to see you do your thing.
Thank you.
You boys are going to play us out. We got time for one more song before we do. I got to thank you, Ed Terry, lead vocals, for being a part of this amazing project. Let's get one more shot of Ed Terry if we can.
Thank you.
We got to thank Teddy Rondinelli over there on guitar. Teddy, thank you so much.
Thank you.
Had a good time in here with you, my man. I really appreciate it. We got to thank Rob DiMartino right over here on the bass.
Thank you, Mark.
Rob, kick ass as always. Love what you're about. And last but certainly not least, Mr. Bobby Rondinelli on the drum kit. We thank you so much, Bobby.
Thanks for having us, Mark.
What else are you working on? Any new things coming up in the near future we can talk about real quick? Anything to speak of that you can talk about?
Not really.
Okay. Well, we'll be on the lookout.
Hopefully more with this lineup.
Good, man. We look forward to seeing it. How about you, Teddy? What the rickety project you're in right now, that going strong?
Right now we're recording.
You're in the studio?
Yep.
Very cool. Look forward to hearing that project and anything you do that's going to definitely, in my opinion, turn to gold. Love what you're about, my man.
Thanks a lot, bro.
Keep going strong. We appreciate it. Please remember to check out EKO Studios of the... right here in Deer Park, New York. Remember, they are the official studio of the Long Island Blues Warehouse. We are going to finish things up tonight. Please say goodbye with this week's featured artist. Thank you, gentlemen. One more time, this is Rondinelli.
Been waiting so long to be where